What we need to do is we need to figure out a way to get the C-suite level people to bring to buy into simulation. They're looking for return on investment, and return on investment in simulation is not necessarily bringing in money. They're looking for revenue. What it does is it saves money.
You oftentimes have to argue for funding from a variety of different people, whether it's your institution or an outside funder. And I think that if you can demonstrate the impact that simulation has had on the patient outcome, the quality of care, the safety of care, the processes of care, then you're going to be really successful in growing your simulation program.
I think from the return on investment piece, obviously, as we talked about, the impact of implementing simulation, both on the practices of our providers and ultimately patient outcomes. And that's where we see the biggest returns, and that's our ultimate goal. We have increasing evidence that we're getting improved patient outcomes by implementing simulation programs.
It actually allows them to do the things they need to do with lower hours for our trainees. And I work in a medical education field. I work in a hospital. We've got to convince them that this is important and will help them do the things they need to do with less time and less resources.
There's clearly enough evidence now that what is learned in the simulation lab does translate into clinical practice.
Get those people who are your key stakeholders to come and put their hands on a mannequin. Experience that adrenaline rush when they are doing chest compressions on a mannequin or delivering a baby or whatever you choose to do.
Get your administrator into a sim. Have them watch it. Videos, books, doesn't do it. My chief nursing officer came in and watched one of our sim camps. She was standing behind me. I could hear her going, wow, oh my, oh. And she walked out of there and she hasn't stopped talking. That was 5 months ago. She is now bought in, a proponent, and sees what happened.
I think if we just look at the research that's been done, especially over the last couple of years, the National Council and the Boards of Nursing just released their study last October that was extensive in looking at how does simulation affect learning, and is it affecting. The determination out of their study was, yes, it is, and that it is a good tool for learning, especially in looking at clinical type of situations.
I needed to get my simulators in front of people. And it was so incredibly important to my advancement of simulation in my institution, because all of a sudden, people from nephrology, people from surgery, people from OB said, hey, that's a really incredible tool.
Over time, since it was a voluntary program, the Risk Management Foundation were following claims. And so they were able to identify those anesthesiologists that had participated in this sort of training and compare them to those anesthesiologists who had decided not to participate in it. And they were able to identify trends in decreasing number of claims for those anesthesiologists that had participated in the training.
Leverage those successes, and that's one of the things that we've done, is that we've had some really great successes, and so we use them as PR tools.
I think the opportunity to practice and not practice on patients is where you really have the opportunity to make the case for simulation.
Justification of simulation is about what's the goals, what's the metrics that you're measuring your success in your day-to-day operations. So for us, quality and patient safety really justifies what we do. At the end of the day, why are we here? We're here to help learners become more confident and competent in their skills, and we're here to keep our patients safe.
And it's ludicrous to think that people coming from separate backgrounds and that don't train together ever are going to come together and give the best care to patients.
Simulation lets you do something special. It gives you that deliberate learning. It gives you feedback, so you know how people are going to react and act in certain situations. So if you have an issue, let's say at your hospital, your facility, or your organization, where there's a patient safety problem, you can confront your clinicians with that problem, find those who make those mistakes so they can learn, and it's not happening with real people. What's that worth?
This is what simulation and debriefing is about. It's a learning strategy so that we can be safe to make mistakes on mannequins and not have to write the check by making a big mistake on a real person.